So in previous session, we had started with module 1, and which we discussed a few concepts related to a digital signal processing system, in which we discussed regarding the block diagrams. So these are the two things what we discussed, and later we started off with the sampling process. So what all things are present in sampling process, the sampling process. That is, if I want to get the analog. If I want to get a digital signal from an analog input, right, then I pass it through two processes, that is sampling and quantization. And in order to go ahead with the sampling, right, we should satisfy the Nyquist criterion, that is FS, that a sampling frequency should be greater than or equal to twice the maximum frequency which is present in the band limited signal. This has to be done to avoid aliasing. So that is what we were discussing. And quantization involves the assigning zeros and ones to the samples what we have obtained based on some conditions. So it may be a quantizer, might be a uniform quantizer or a non-uniform quantizer, depending on what type of quantizer you are using, how many bits will be utilized. So those all things will be checked out. Okay. So this we had discussed. So where all I'll be getting the samples. When sampling frequency is equal to the signal frequency, that is every time period, every one time period of the sampling frequency, I'll be taking one sample. So that is what is represented as I keep on increasing, right? What is happening is, in previous case, I have around 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6 sampling points. Here I have increased the sampling frequency by slight amount, due to which I have one extra sample. Similarly here, still little bit higher, so I have 8 sampling points. So if I keep on doing that, I'll be getting more number of samples, so which will help us to avoid aliasing. So let us look at one coding aspect. The input signal. When I take samples using FS1, but FS1 is not satisfying the sampling condition, so it is having undersampling aspect. So here we can see that one sample is say having at zero, next sample is at some other point, next sample here, next sample here, next sample here. So you can see that if I hide the signal, and if I just give you this information and ask you to recover the signal, it becomes really difficult to tell that it was a cos wave or a sine wave. It was in this form, because it depends on how you realize it. You might realize it depending on what iterations you put in. So it is undersampled. What happens is, I'll not be able to get back the original information. So here, so this is how it appears. That is, these are the number of samples. I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 samples. So total 9 samples are present. So when I just plot it here, what we are doing is just I'm trying to join and see whether I'm very close to this signal, whether I'm close to this signal. So if I just observe, I have used a linear interpolation over there. So when I join the samples, right, with linear interpolation, what is happening? This signal is totally different as this, whatever recovered information is there, right? This is totally different from this one, because I'm having very a few number of samples, due to which I'll not be able to make up what the signal actually was. Now let us go for the next this thing, wherein I'm taking again more number of, that is from minus 5 to plus 5. We'll just see, because even one in one time period, if I just satisfy that, that is sufficient. So I'm just taking the range in this one. So next, here what I'm doing, I'm taking the condition of FS2. FS2 is for critical sampling. If you just say it is 2 times FM. Now what happens is, since FM divided by FS2 you're considering, you'll be getting more number of samples as compared to this one. So if you just see over there, right? So here we can see that I am getting more number of samples. Here, how many I had? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 samples I had. Here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, around 11 samples are there, which is more than this. But what happens is, even in this condition, depending on what type of interpolation you are putting, either it will be close to this or it might not be as close as related, but it tries to get as close as possible. So this is the samples what I have got for this input signal. Now when I just move on, right, and I say take linear interpolation over there. So this is how the signal would appear. Now I'll tell that this is not similar to the input signal, but it is somewhat close because what we have done is we have joined it with assuming that it is a linear interpolation. If I had used sine interpolation, slight curve would appear and it would be near to this one. So even in this condition, right, I might not be able to get back the original information, but what happens is you will be avoiding aliasing in this case. Now if I go for oversampling, so this is for uniform sampling or critical sampling. Now if I go for more number of samples, if I take more number of samples and I consider FS3, which is 8 times FM, so which is oversampling condition. So in this case, right, so I am getting these many samples over here. Now you can see that if I keep on increasing the number of samples, right, I'll be getting more and increasing FS, right, I'll be getting more and more samples. So here you can see that there are more number of samples compared to the previous case. Now even if I go for linear interpolation, it might be very close to what is the input signal. So here again, just assuming the linear interpolation, that is just we are joining the sample points. We are joining the sample points here. So if I do that, what is happening? This is how the signal would appear. This is how it appears. So it is somewhat close to this input signal. Now depending on whether you want sine or whether you want a linear interpolation or other stuff, this would change. So this is what is happening when we are taking the oversampling condition. So you can just see that this is the oversampling condition. So you can see the differences what is present. This is the input signal. This is undersampling, wherein number of samples are less. And if I use some interpolation and try to get back, I'll not be close enough to, even very close enough to the input signal. So that is one thing. So next one, uniform sampling, it is somewhat close to this one. This gives rise to aliasing, whereas this avoids that aliasing. This is the critical condition which avoids the aliasing. Then after that, if you keep on increasing, aliasing will be totally absent. So this is what happens in this case. For example, instead of 8, right, I will just take into 18. Let us run and see what happens. First condition, next condition, that is uniform sampling, last one. So here you can see that you are having more number of samples. Now here, what is happening is you are taking more number of samples and you'll be able to get back the original information. So you cannot even go for very high number of sampling also because it will be adding to the entire stuff wherein memory requirement and other things become critical. So even I cannot go for very high sampling rate. So this is with respect to MATLAB code which we have gone through, in which we discussed about sampling process. Now going ahead, let us see what are the other steps. So what happens if sampling is not proper? So this is one example, say even the previous discussion was related to one dimensional sampling. Now when you go ahead, right, say if you take images, you have to take care of two dimensional sampling information. So wherein sampling has to be done in two dimension, whereas in the other case, right, say S of T is a signal, only along the time period axis you are taking care of sampling. Along the other part, it is the amplitude. But when you consider the image, right, that time what happens is you have X and Y axis for the images. So I have to take care of that information. You have to sample along X axis with the condition what is specified, Nyquist criteria, and even along the Y axis. Even in any one direction, if it is not satisfied, you will be having the aliasing effect in that particular case, and due to which the overall image gets distorted. So that is how. So this is the image of a letter which is highly sampled. This is the image of the same letter in which number of samples are less. So the due to observation, we can make it okay. It is letter A in such cases. Even here, you can see another image. So in your system, right? If you just go to system, in your display setting, if I take, so here you have some resolution. So this is nothing but again, what you're doing is you're reducing the number of pixels. So indirectly, you are changing the sample space. So this is the highest which is present. Now here. If you just see the letters over here, right, they are displayed a little bit sharp in form. When I go for, a lower one, so what happens is, you can see that images become slightly blur because you have reduced the number of pixels. So here you can just see that the letters which are used for these purposes, they turn out to be slightly blur. It is because the number of pixels which get reduced. If I make it 125%, so this is how it is appearing, and if I make it this one, so this is how it appears. So you can just observe the changes which are present. So here, number of pixels, in this case, what you're doing is you're just changing the number of pixels which are being utilized. More number of pixels will give you a better and sharper details. So next, this thing which comes is discrete time sequences. So in this case, you have already gone through these discrete time sequences. So whenever you have a analog signal and you pass it through the sampling process, you get a signal what we call as discrete signal. Once we pass it through quantization, right, we term it as digital signal. After passing through the sampling process, the signal is termed as a discrete signal, and we get a sequence over there. So in your DSP, you had used the sequences as X of N, if you remember. So those are the time sequences, whatever input signal was there when you take the sampling, right? Those samples you are considering. So that is the discrete time sequence. So in this case, right? So if X of T is a continuous signal, say it is a periodic signal in this case, what we are discussing, it can be a periodic also. So this is a periodic signal. So I'll not stress on periodic. It is just an analog signal because it is defined for continuous time. Then if we sample this X of T at some particular sampling rate, then we get what we call as samples. We get what is called as samples. So that is what is given in this equation, wherein instead of taking entire value of t, this t, what you do is you take at particular intervals and particular time period. So with respect to this, you take the samples. So that was what was present in the previous case, what we had discussed. Now there might be one question as to when I took 18, right, the signal was not appearing as this, as it should have appeared. Now it was because the n value what I had chosen, I hadn't changed that. I should have changed that, then it would be close enough to the original signal. I should have changed that, so that change I did not do. So that change should be incorporated over there in the code. So otherwise, rest of the part is nothing. I just change the sampling frequency, and I should make the changes for n also. Based on that, I'll be getting the appropriate condition. So here, what happens is, if you take only few of the samples with respect to the sampling rate, and if this particular case also should satisfy. So this T is nothing but the sampling rate, which sometimes we represent it as TS, which is equivalent to 1 by FS. So this should be satisfied. No matter what, the condition has to be satisfied. So here what I am doing is, I am not taking the entire this thing, only particular samples I am taking with respect to the sampling period. And say if it is a time period signal, I should try to see what all stuff I have to change. Now here I am just considering 0, 1, 2 and so on. So n will be a number integer, say it can be from 0 to infinity, or it can depend on say minus 2, some other value. So here, so wherever t is there, if I just take a few of the samples, so I just replace that. So this t is replaced with nt, and I think you are regularly using this expression, So it is just for simplicity, instead of writing every time n into t, right? What we do is we write it as, we generally write it in this form, x of n. So this is nothing but the discrete time sequence what we get. So this is the discrete time sequence what we get once we sample this original signal with respect to the sampling rate. So it is for just simplicity, we note it as x of n, which is equivalent to the samples what we have taken with respect to the sampling frequency. Now, as I just mentioned previously, the sampling frequency is equal to 1 by t. Now, if I put it in the above equation, right, if I substitute this in this equation, then what I have is x of n is equal to this case, wherein it is from this equation 2 pi f n into capital T. Now, if I replace this, so t is equal to 1 by fs. So here what I get is 2 pi fn is as it is, this t will be replaced with 1 by fs. So here if you just observe, if I just simplify it, it turns out to be n into theta, where theta is called as the digital frequency of this sequence, because this is a periodic signal. For that purpose, we are specifying it as a digital frequency over here. So this equation only was used for sampling purpose previous in the code. 2 pi fm divided by fs1 into n, whatever value we were specifying over there. So here theta is nothing but the digital frequency, which is given by this particular equation. Since it is 2 pi, right, it will be in terms of radians. This is 2 pi, right? It will be in terms of radians. It will not be in terms of degrees when you're estimating it. If you change this parameter, then the unit also changes. But generally, SI unit for angle will be radians. It will be radians. That's why you're keeping it in this form. Now here x of n is called the discrete time sequence. Now since it is a periodic signal, and since it is a cos this thing, right, we call it as a sinusoidal sequence. Now similarly, we come across so many different sequences. Here we have another one, this is an exponential sequence, and it is a complex exponential sequence. So when you just estimate it, it turns out to be cj theta, cj sine theta, that is cos of this value plus j sine of this value. So that is how it turns out. So this is a complex exponential sequence. Okay, so these are the discrete sequences which we come across. And apart from this, we can see different time sequences also based on what signal you are sampling. Suppose I want to sample the voice signal, say, which is in this particular form. So this is your voice signal, which is in continuous. Now what I do is, based on fs, right, I take the sample, say I'm satisfying the condition. So these discrete values what I get, that gives rise to the discrete sequence of the voice signal. These all samples will give rise to a discrete sequence of the voice signal. If you remember, you used to write something in this form. Say if it is x of n, then you used to put it something as 0, 1, 2. So these all things you used to write. These may be the voltage representations or the intensity representations. So depending on what information you are choosing. Okay. So this is just a few examples of the discrete time sequence. So similarly, we can obtain samples of other analog signals and represent it in discrete time sequences. So again, another topic to discuss on this one is what is meant by periodic sequence. Periodic sequence is nothing but a signal which repeats itself after a particular time interval. Okay. A signal which repeats itself after a particular time interval. Now, what is meant by periodic sequence? If the signal turns out to be a discrete time sequence, and if it is repeating itself after some particular time period, then we call it as a periodic sequence. So sequence is used when you have taken the samples. So that is what you have to remember. Sequence you get only when you take the samples. So as I mentioned, the sequence, it repeats itself after some particular time period, as we had seen in the previous this thing, right? Slide. So in that you can just check out, that is, here in these cases. So these samples which are there, right? These are the sequences. Now here we can see that this sequence is repeating itself. This sequence is repeating itself. So this is a periodic sequence. This one I cannot tell whether it is a periodic sequence or aperiodic. If the samples are repeating after some particular time interval, if I had taken few more, right, then I would have made out, okay, after this particular period, again, it is repeating. So I'll not be sure in that case. Here I can make out, okay, this is a periodic sequence. So this is one period. This is second next period. This is the third period. This is the fourth. So here I can make out. So this is with respect to the periodic sequence. So sequence, I use the term when I have taken the samples from the continuous signal. That is, in short, in your DSP, you regularly use it as x of n. So this is nothing but a sequence. Now this will be periodic if it repeats itself. If it repeats itself. Okay. Now, how do I represent the period for a discrete signal? For continuous signal, what happens is I specify it as t plus t, where t is the time period. Similarly, for discrete, I have x of n. It should be equivalent to x of n plus n. If this condition is satisfied, then only I can classify it as a periodic sequence, or else I cannot classify it as a periodic sequence. By observation, if it is repeating, I can just specify, okay, it is a periodic sequence. But if I mathematically I want to just check out, I have to see whether this equation is satisfied or not. If it is not satisfied, then it is a periodic sequence. (Clears throat)
And in this case, n is the period of the sequence what you have considered. Now, another parameter to consider is to identify the frequency response. Now, if you want to obtain a frequency response, right, you should obtain the say Fourier series or Fourier spectrum of the signal what you're considering. In order to do that, right, what we do is, this is the equation what we use. So in this one, x of e j theta, so this is the transformation what we are looking, and since it is a periodic sequence what we are speaking at present, so here what happens is, you have 0 to n minus 1, so these many number of samples are present over there, and x of n, you multiply it with this parameter, e raised to j n theta. So that is what you just check out. So this is the equation what we use in order to obtain the frequency response of the discrete signal. I'm just speaking in terms of discrete signal. Now, where theta is the digital frequency and x of theta gives you both information. That is, it gives you the magnitude information, e raised to j theta, and it gives you the angle information, that which is the phase information. It gives you the phase information. So this is, let us wind up here. So this is for